بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah, the compassionate, the most merciful. Our viewers out there, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace and blessings of Allah be upon all of you, and thanking you for joining us in the rational, the intersection of faith and reason with our guest here, Dr. Ja'far Sheikh Idris. Dr. Ja'far, as always, good to be with you, sir. In previous episodes, Sheikh, we spoke about this harmony between Islam and science. And the more advanced we get, the more beneficial it's becoming to humanity, but it is also bringing with it some challenges. And looking into some of the work that you have done, you've actually presented a paper on genetic engineering, and I believe you called it Our Humanity and Genetic Engineering. That will be our topic for this episode and a discussion of the paper that you presented.
I was invited to a conference here in Cairo on it was on genetic engineering, and the participants were people from almost all over the world. They were, some of them were scientists, some philosophers, some theologians, and so on, because the this question of genetic engineering made people raise many questions, some very fundamental questions. And the topic I chose was about what does it mean to be human, because this was related also to genetic engineering. And I tried to give the Islamic, what I thought would be the Islamic answer to this question.
Sheikh, it's interesting that you're saying that the way we address it is, what does it mean to be human?
Yes.
And as if that's not very...
For genetic engineering, because the question was raised, because the question is, can genetic engineering change our nature? So my reply was that what is the nature of a thing? Anything, whether it is human or inanimate or animal, so my reply was that the nature of a thing is the collection of the qualities that make it what it is. Now, if those qualities change, then the thing will not be the thing that we know.
Sure.
So everything, whether it is an animal or something material or so, we say this water, this is water, because it is composed of H2O, two molecules of hydrogen, molecule of oxygen. If that changes, then this is no longer water.
Because its qualities
Have changed. The same thing applies to everything else. So I said, my reply to the question is that logically, there must be human nature. There must be a human nature. If that nature changes, then that thing will not be the human being that we know.
Sure.
So this is not a question of this is not a question that needs a scientific answer. This is a question that can be answered just logically. This was my so I said that the real question would be, what is that nature? Not whether we have nature or not. That question, the first question must be settled, that we must have a nature. What kind of nature do we have?
As humans.
As humans. Do we have a fixed nature? Do we have a fixed nature? Or is our nature, as some people would say, a tabula rasa, something like a blank sheet on which our culture, the environment, and now genetic engineering can dictate what they want. So in that case, we will not be having a fixed nature. If it is a nature that is made up by culture, and culture changes, then that nature will change with the change in culture.
Sure.
If it changes with the change of environment, then it will not be fixed nature, and so on. So,
Sheikh, before we go on, what would be the implications Oh, if the question is answered either way, whether it's fixed or changing.
Yes, inshallah, we'll answer this question, but I can give a quick answer to it. If we don't have any fixed nature, then genetic engineering can do what it wants, and every time there will be a new being. If you change the nature of what we call now a human being, if you change this nature, it will be something else, and you can give it another name. If the nature is fixed, then genetic engineering cannot change that nature. It will distort the nature of the human being. And again, that will be something else, not the human being that we spoke about. So what kind of nature do we have? I said it is obvious, for example, that we have bodies. That we have bodies. This is something obvious. But they are special bodies. I mean, our body is not like a body of a horse or a camel or so. This is a human body, and because this body has a nature, has a nature, it requires so many things for it to continue to be, and so on. We have also mental qualities, which it seems to be clear, are very necessary for something to be human. To have these, to have what seemed to me to be three necessary mental qualities. The ability to think, the ability to know, and the ability to will. If something is intrinsically lacking these three things, then I don't think you can call it a human being.
So the collection of our physical appearance in the form of a body that we have, in addition to the mental qualities, intrinsic mental qualities that enumerated some of them, would give us what we know to be the fixed nature of
the
human
being.
Because
the body by itself, and you must have seen some apes that look very much like human beings, but they lack these qualities, so they cannot be human. Now, can engineering, can genetic engineering make any change in these qualities? It seems it can. Just like even without genetic engineering, you can make mutilate a human person, and as a result make changes in his mental abilities. So that will not be the usual human being that we know. But because we know that this person used to have these qualities, this is not like what we call intrinsically unable
to think or to know these other qualities.
So if this a new being is intrinsically unable to have these, then we'll not say that this is a human being. Can genetic engineering do this? It seems it can. But the person or the being that it comes up with as a result of that interference will not be the human being. Will that change all human beings, all humanity? No. I said that this will apply only to the people with whom this genetic engineering interfered. We don't know whether they will continue to reproduce as other human beings did, whether their offspring will be like them. We don't know this. But fortunately, other human beings will be there, and they will continue to reproduce as usual.
And continue to produce the humanity as we know it.
So I said that, so I'm not very much worried about I don't want this to happen even to one human being. But to say that this will change humanity is not true. They will not interfere with or do this to all human beings all over the world.
Jeff, in your paper, after you presented this part of it, the question that was asked, is it in the best interest of humanity to allow such things to take place?
No. That was my conclusion, and it was just like agreed with some other non-Muslims that were concerned with this problem, some scientists, some theologians, some philosophers. We don't think so. We don't think that it is in the... And my answer was, as a Muslim, I think that the human being is the best animal, at least, the best animal. So if you make, you cannot make any change in it and make it better. Because as it is the best animal. It is best than all the animals that we know. So you cannot make it an angel if angels are better than human beings. There's a difference of opinion about this among the Muslims, that it is not very clear that angels are better than human beings, because some human beings are better than angels, like the prophets of God are better than some human beings. And some angels are better than some human beings. So we are not, I don't think that the human being they create or bring about will be something better than the human being that we
that
know.
That already is out there. Sheikh, you also mentioned that within Islam, there are added qualities to the to how peculiar or how special a human being is, in addition to the ability to think, to know, and to will, and that physical appearance as well.
Yes. I said in the paper that there is something common between human beings and other creation. Many people are not aware of this. And according to the Quran, all created things have three qualities.
Including the
all created things, whether they are animals or inanimate things or human beings, angels or so. There are four things in common to them.
Sheikh, before we go on to these four things, we have to take a short break and we will be back inshallah. So please do stay tuned. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and thank you for joining us back again in the Rational, the intersection of faith and reason. Sheikh Jaffer, before we took the break, you were about to enumerate certain things where all created things share.
Yes. In their relationship to their creator. In the Quran, everything is a Muslim.
Interesting.
Yes.
Not every human.
No, everything.
When you say a
thing... وَلَّهُ أَسْلَمَ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ.
And a Muslim
see,
here means...
And it's the same meaning. It submits. It submits to its creator. So... Islam, in fact, has there are three categories of Muslims. One is that all creation is Muslim. The second, that all those who accepted the messages of earlier prophets are Muslims. Mm. And with a special sense that we now use, all those who accepted the message of Prophet Muhammad are Muslim. So there are three categories of Muslim. So all creation is Muslim.
And that includes the animals, the plants,
everything.
The mountains.
Yes.
Everything.
And everything makes, glorifies God. سَبَّحَ سَبَّحَ إِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ.
Allah sings the glorification, whatever is on heaven, whatever is
and everything's on earth. Everything prostrate, makes sujood to Allah. Yes, please.
Sheikh, I'm sorry, when you say everything, you are literally meaning the word everything.
Yes. But it makes its sujood in its own way, according to its own nature. All these different creations have different natures. So they make submission according to their nature. They glorify God according to their nature. They make prostration according to their nature. And they are obedient to God according qunut. Qunut means obedience. So human beings, as created things, have these four qualities with other human, with other creation. No.
Interesting.
But humans have something special.
In addition to these four
things.
Yes,
they have something special. First, Adam, according to the Quran, as you know, was created in a special way. This is an honor to human beings that God created the first human being, it is said in the Quran, with my own hands. Mm-hmm. So it is not like the creation of other animals or even other beings. This is one thing. Then,
Sheikh, when you say with his own hands, you're saying that the molding of a human being, according to the Quran,
we don't know the how of it.
Right, you know, but the reference was it has a way to who, when I have molded him and shaped him and.
خلقت بيدي.
خلقت بيدي. Created with my own.
With my own hands. خلقت بيدي. With my own hands. Then he made breathed into him a special thing called ruh. Hmm. Ruh. Some people make the mistake of thinking that this ruh is part of God. It left him and resided in the human being. And some very good Muslim thinkers think so, but this is wrong. And as a result, they say that there's a divine element in the human being. This is not true, mm-hmm. because the ruh is one of God's creation. Mm. It is not part of the Creator. What is the nature of that ruh? We don't know, but we know some of its activities as human beings. Mm-hmm. So he was created.
So in other words, divinity is not to be assigned to us.
There is, according to Islam, there is nothing divine except the Creator. Now, it seems that because of this, there was a further honoring of the human being, that God made all the angels prostrate to Adam. And that's where the Shaitan, Satan, refused to do this, and he said he argued that Adam is created from mud and I am created from fire, so why should I prostrate to him? One Muslim theologian said, why did he think that fire is better than mud? And then he began to give reasons why mud is better than fire. mud is better than fire. Then, according to the Quran, Allah, the Creator, made all this creation around us subservient to the human being. This creation and the place of human beings in this world that we see is a special place. The earth was created for him, the sun, and for him, animals, for him, plants, and so on. Mm-hmm. So Allah sakhara, made everything subservient to the human being. Mm-hmm. And also, God gave him dignity that you spoke about in the
وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ Indeed, we have honored the children of Adam.
كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ وَحَمَلْنَاهُمْ فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ حَمَلْنَاهُمْ فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ Now, I'm going to express just a personal idea. I thought about this verse, and I asked myself, perhaps you have an answer to it. Is there any animal or being other than human beings that travels by sea? Because Allah says, حَمَلْنَاهُمْ فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ. And even by land, they don't just walk. They use other animals or machines also. This is one of the this is one of the ways in which God honored human beings. It made it easy for them to use other things for traveling, whether in the sea or in the land.
And Sheikh, that's expressed in so many places in the Quran, and I think collectively, I believe in Surah Al-Baqarah, سَخَّرَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ.
Yes. Yes, yes. Then perhaps the last one that I thought of was knowledge. So the human being has this, is made up of these two distinct, it's very clear that these are two distinct entities, body and soul. The proof for this, for the fact that these are distinct, is that from the verses of the Quran, it's very clear that Adam was first made of this of this mud, and then the ruh, the spirit, was breathed into him. So the spirit is something different from the body. Also, a person, and this is something I found interesting when I was writing this paper. Perhaps some people will find it puzzling. It seems that what is meant by the soul is not just the thing that makes a person alive. Because even animals are alive, but they don't have this special soul that God breathed to. And there's an evidence also in the hadith, you remember the hadith, that when is the soul breathed into the human being? After about 40 days.
Right.
But before that, it was alive. That's why some scholars say that you can have abortion before that. Because that is not yet a human being. Of course, there is difference of opinion about it. But this shows clearly that the soul is something different from whatever that makes an animal living, because animals also have things. Also, the soul, at the hour of death, the soul leaves the body. So it must be something different from the body. The fourth evidence is that in the hereafter, especially in paradise, people will have different bodies. I mean, not different, but I mean they will have a different body. The nature of that body will not be the same as the nature of the body that we have now. For example, people never get tired, they never sleep. They don't go to the bathroom. So they must be having a body that is different from the body that we have now. All this goes to prove that the most important thing is the soul and not the body. The body is subservient to the soul. But the soul cannot work without this body.
Interesting. Sheikh, I'm not sure if you know of any other beliefs or faith groups that have the same distinction that we Muslims have with regard to faith.
I think Christians and Jews and Jewish people have the same distinction.
Interesting. Yeah. Interesting.
Because they all believe that Adam was created in a special way and so on. In all these books there is. It is only some of the crude materialists who say that only bodies exist. And they find it their position cannot be defended. Because what about thinking? Thinking is not something. They say that it comes as a result of some change in the brain. But still, this is not something physical. Every person can know from his own experience that to will or to think, to love, or so on, is something different from having some bodily change. Okay. So there is a proof even in our personal life that there is something other than
this physical
body.
Okay. Sheikh, do me a favor, I think we're just making an introduction to the final conclusion with regard to Islam and genetic engineering.
Yes.
But we will have to save this for the next time we meet, inshallah. With this, we come to the conclusion of this part of our program. Thanking you for joining us and hoping that you would join us next time as well. Until then, we say so long and assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.